Good afternoon and welcome to all our delegates and speakers to the session on driving a vision for regional integration. The subject of Africa and energy is an exciting and a vibrant one. In the last month alone, we have seen significant investment announcements in the areas of gas to power, renewable energy, coal power, and even nuclear. All of this probably amounting to over $100 billion if one adds them up. The continent remains an attractive destination. However, yet for all the investment, some of the largest projects and biggest potential resides in regional energy integration. And unlocking this, multilateral, multinational projects remains a challenge. Some of them, conceptualized for many decades, remain in the planning stage, and several have been stalled for many years. Various reasons for slow progress in the continent. Africa needs to learn from lessons from across the world when it comes to regional integration projects, such as South America, Central America, and other economies. Regional economies. The World Energy Council, together with the Deloitte, has published a paper on regional energy integration, where we reviewed the progress of some 20 priority projects using the five-stage infrastructure lifecycle. We found that only six projects had made progress since 2015. Many remain stalled in the planning stages, developing project feasibility, demonstrating bankability are the key stumbling blocks to the process. And some of the critical success factors for the regional projects are vision and leadership, as well as transparency, strong government support, and political stability. However, there has been some progress in areas such as the Southern African Power Pool, establishing a project acceleration unit, and signing several intergovernmental agreements to progress projects so that next year can be a better year for progress. With me today is the panel that will help unpack the subject of a vision for regional energy integration. I want to kick off by soliciting some initial viewpoints on what would it take to achieve successful regional integration for Africa. And let's kick off with Commissioner Bangura from ECOWAS.
Merci, Monsieur le Moderateur. Avant que je n'introduise, je voudrais au nom du président de la Commission, adresser toutes nos félicitations, notre profonde gratitude au Conseil mondial de l'énergie, au gouvernement turc pour l'accueil chaleureux et de nous avoir invités à participer, à échanger avec vous la vision de la Commission de la CEDEAO sur le problème d'intégration. Problème d'intégration qui doit favoriser le développement des infrastructures énergétiques. On va parler français, hein? Voilà. Et avant de continuer, je vais faire une brève présentation de la CEDEAO. La CEDEAO, c'est 15 États membres. 8 États francophones, 5 États anglophones, 2 États lusophones. Vous allez comprendre la diversité de la CEDEAO. C'est 320 millions d'habitants. C'est 5,1 millions de kilomètres carrés. Voilà l'espace grandiose de la CEDEAO, un marché énorme concernant l'électricité. La CEDEAO a été créée en mai 1975 par la volonté des chefs d'État de se mettre ensemble pour pouvoir construire le devenir de la population de la CEDEAO, puisque seul on ne peut rien faire. Nous avons d'immenses potentialités énergétiques. Je ne vais pas en venir. Depuis que nous avons commencé la session, Dimanche, nous ne parlons que de cette précarité énergétique en Afrique, malgré nos immenses potentialités énergétiques. Comme l'a dit Macky Sall, le président, son excellence Macky Sall, à la dernière Assemblée générale, c'est que l'Afrique a d'immenses potentialités énergétiques. Elle nourrit les autres pays et elle vit dans la précarité énergétique. C'est inadmissible. Inadmissible, tant plus qu'il faut vraiment faire les efforts pour qu'on puisse arriver à attirer, n'est-ce pas, notre continent de cette précarité énergétique. La moitié de la population sur le continent africain n'a pas accès à l'électricité. Et plus pire, l'électrification rurale a un taux très faible. Dans ma sous-région, c'est 8%. Et c'est 77% de la population qui vit en milieu rural en ce siècle moderne. C'est inadmissible. Donc, les chefs d'État, dès après la création de la CEDEAO, 7 ans après, ils ont adopté la politique énergétique régionale. Ça veut dire quoi? Ça veut dire que les chefs d'État ont volontairement exprimé cette volonté politique à mettre ensemble les ressources énergétiques pour éradiquer la pauvreté énergétique. Ça prend du temps, mais cette volonté politique, elle est là. Et depuis lors, la CEDEAO a été mandatée de mettre sur place les instruments nécessaires pour pouvoir, n'est-ce pas, faire face à la mise en œuvre de ces grands projets régionaux. Pour rassurer, puisque c'est un secteur à haute intensité de capital, ça a besoin de beaucoup d'argent. Nous allons en parler. Et la CEDEAO a mis en place des paramètres, a mis en place des politiques, a mis en place des règlements pour pouvoir rassurer ceux que les investisseurs qui vont mettre dans l'espace CEDEAO. C'est ainsi qu'on a fait avec l'OMC et la charte sur l'énergie de la CEDEAO, la charte sur l'énergie, le protocole sur l'énergie. Ce protocole sur l'énergie définit les bases solides et juridiques, n'est-ce pas, de pouvoir investir dans l'espace CEDEAO. Un. De deux, les chefs d'État ont mandaté la Commission à créer des institutions qui vont répondre aux investisseurs, qui vont garantir, n'est-ce pas, le problème d'investissement. C'est ainsi que ça a été créé le West African Power Pool. Je crois que certains parmi vous le connaissent, puisque nous faisons des tables rondes avec les bailleurs de fonds sur les projets. Ce West African Power Pool a pour tâche de mettre en vigueur, de mettre en implémentation les projets régionaux, le plan directeur production-transport de la CEDEAO, c'est-à-dire le plan de production et d'interconnexion entre les États. Ce plan énergétique prévoit horizon 2025. Nous sommes là pour le moment sur l'horizon 2025. 10 000 MW à implanter, 16 000 km de lignes à faire, des énergies renouvelables. Donc, ce plan existe et que nous suivons. Dans ce projet, il existe des projets qui sont au niveau continental dans les 15 projets prioritaires du PIDA, PAP, et dans les 51 projets du projet PIDA. Nous allons en parler. Donc, ça, c'est la première institution. La deuxième institution est la mise en place, puisqu'il y aura beaucoup d'acteurs dans le secteur. Le secteur a besoin du public et du privé. Donc, elle a mis en place l'autorité régionale de régulation du secteur de l'électricité. C'est très important parce qu'il faut pouvoir rassurer les investisseurs qui y viennent. Troisièmement, puisque nous avons des potentialités d'énergie renouvelable, solaire, éolienne et autres, il faut forcément, puisque c'est l'avenir, nous en avons, au cours de cette réunion, c'est l'avenir pour l'énergie durable pour nos populations. Donc, nous avons créé le Centre des énergies renouvelables et de l'efficacité énergétique, qui aujourd'hui fait la promotion des énergies renouvelables, des projets d'énergie renouvelable, qui a établi la politique régionale des énergies renouvelables et de l'efficacité énergétique, qui sont assortis des plans d'action. Ça, c'est les chefs d'État l'ont adopté. Quatrièmement, nous avons du gaz. C'est vrai qu'on nous a dit dans certaines conférences ici que d'ici 2040, il faut laisser dans le sous-sol les combustibles fossiles. C'est bien. Certains États ont atteint ce développement. Aujourd'hui, nous sommes en train de faire la transition énergétique du fossile vers les renouvelables. Mais disposant de ces innombrables ressources, Nous sommes actuellement de faire de prolonger le gazoduc puisque nous avons un gazoduc existant qui va du Nigeria au Ghana et les chefs d'État ont décidé de pouvoir prolonger ce gazoduc au niveau des 15 États. C'est pour, n'est-ce pas, puisque le taux d'accès à l'électricité est très faible dans les villes, c'est 35% en moyenne au niveau de la CEDEAO. C'est 8% au niveau rural. Donc, cet organe a été mis en place et nous avons créé l'autorité de régulation du gazoduc et la société en partenariat public-privé qui exploite ce gazoduc. Donc, ces institutions ont été créées pour rassurer, n'est-ce pas, les investisseurs qui y viennent. Les grands projets que nous sommes en train d'implémenter permettent de vendre de l'énergie à moindre coût aux populations, puisque ces importantes ressources énergétiques sont inégalement reparties. Il y a une partie où vous avez continuellement le désert, donc il y a une partie où vous avez la végétation et l'hydroélectricité comme la Guinée, et comme le Nigeria, qui ont les 60% des potentialités hydroénergétiques de la sous-région. Donc, toutes ces institutions ont été créées. Et qu'est-ce que la CEDEAO a fait encore? Puisqu'il y a des contraintes douanières et tout ce qui s'ensuit, nous avons créé le tarif extérieur commun. C'est pour harmoniser, homogénéiser aux frontières de la CEDEAO les procédures douanières et les taxes et les impôts. Ce tarif extérieur commun est rentré en vigueur au 1er janvier 2015. Et la finalisation de l'adoption ou de la mise en vigueur de ce tarif extérieur commun va finir en 2017. Tous les pays auront, n'est-ce pas, adopté. Et nous aurons la traçabilité de toutes les importations qu'ils nous allons faire. Puisque l'adoption, le développement des énergies renouvelables permet de décentraliser la production jusqu'au fond fin des villages. Aujourd'hui, vous pouvez aller dans les villages avec les panneaux solaires et faire de l'éclairage. Il faut inciter les gens à y venir. Nous venons de la table ronde où il y a des entreprises qui sont aujourd'hui capables d'aller dans les fonds fins des villages pour distribuer cette énergie. C'est vrai, ils rencontrent des difficultés, ils rencontrent des problèmes, mais l'organisation régionale est là pour harmoniser toutes les politiques, n'est-ce pas, au niveau des frontières de la CEDEAO. Ça, c'est la première, l'une des mesures. La deuxième mesure, c'est quoi? La deuxième mesure, c'est de permettre, n'est-ce pas, la mobilité, n'est-ce pas, à l'intérieur de l'espace CEDEAO. C'est très important, puisque quand vous rentrez à partir de la Guinée, pour que vous ayez la possibilité de pouvoir parcourir les 15 États sans trop de tracasser. Donc, la libre circulation des biens et des personnes est une réalité sur le terrain aujourd'hui. Troisièmement, nous avons adopté la carte d'identité biométrique qui va être en vigueur bientôt. Ça remplace la carte de résidence. Puisque quand vous allez dans un pays, il faut trouver la carte de résidence qui vous permette de travailler ou de choses. Mais cette carte d'identité biométrique va être utilisée par n'importe quel citoyen de la CEDEAO pour pouvoir s'installer dans n'importe quel pays. Puisque l'objectif de la CEDEAO, c'est tendre vers la CEDEAO des peuples. Nous sommes actuellement dans la CEDEAO des États. Nous allons tendre vers la CEDEAO des peuples, citoyens de la CEDEAO. Et ayant cette carte, vous pouvez aller vous installer et faire votre business dans n'importe quel État de la CEDEAO. C'est ambitieux, mais nous sommes en train de le faire progressivement. La CEDEAO est très jeune, elle n'a que 40 ans. C'est vrai? Mais beaucoup de progrès ont été faits dans cette communauté pour, n'est-ce pas, harmoniser nos politiques, pour harmoniser nos directives afin de faciliter, n'est-ce pas, les investisseurs privés. Parce que vous ne pouvez pas développer le secteur énergétique sans l'apport des privés. C'est difficile parce que l'État ne peut pas faire tout seul. Donc voilà les quelques actions que la communauté régionale de la CEDEAO est en train de mener sur le terrain. Et je voudrais, si vous permettez de terminer, je suis très content pour ce journal-là. Ce journal-là a aujourd'hui présenté la carte de l'Afrique en énergie renouvelable. C'est intéressant. Je trouve formidable cette carte et je rêve que quand nous allons mettre en action, avec vous, avec les partenaires privés, avec les partenaires institutionnels, que cette carte des énergies renouvelables, avec la mise en œuvre, Mme Hidal va me permettre, des projets PIDA, les 51 projets, que cette carte soit noircie d'ici 2040 pour qu'on ait beaucoup d'énergie renouvelable, beaucoup de stations d'énergie renouvelable, que de l'efficacité énergétique pour s'exercer. C'est un beau tableau qu'on va réactualiser, mais au fil du temps, au prochain congrès, pour qu'on puisse voir comment nous avons évolué au niveau du continent africain. C'est un cri qu'on passe en tant que commissaire énergie et mine de la CEDEAO pour vous dire que les investisseurs sont les bienvenus et les projets à caractère régional, on va en parler puisque nous en avons beaucoup. Nous avons des lignes d'interconnexion. Comment nous le faisons? Comment les États y participent? Quelle est la gestion que nous avons mise en place? Nous avons des centrales à vocation régionale, comme la centrale de Manantali, mon frère de l'Afrique du Sud est là. Ce sont eux qui ont exploité cette centrale à caractère régional. Et la NOFCOR que nous sommes en train de faire du Nigeria, en passant par le Niger, le Burkina, le Ghana, le Bénin et le Togo, c'est une ligne de près de 3000 km. Nous allons en parler. Nous sommes en train de chercher des fonds pour que, n'est-ce pas, nous pouvons exécuter ces projets. Voilà, succinctement ramassé pour ne pas monopoliser le temps. En attendant que les questions puissent y venir, voilà comment notre vision de la CEDEAO tournée vers l'avenir pour que nous soyons éclairés. Voilà, nous soyons éclairés. Éclairés qu'on ait de la lumière. Voilà, que nos taux de disponibilité ou d'accès qu'on prévoit d'ici 2040, si je ne me trompe, c'est d'ici 2030, c'est 60% de taux d'accès que nous voulons avoir. Le taux de mixage des énergies renouvelables d'ici 2030 au niveau de la CEDEAO, on va atteindre les 40%, puisque aujourd'hui, elle est très faible. Le photovoltaïque fait 1% dans le mixage, dans le mix énergétique. Merci, monsieur le modérateur, et nous serons disposés à pouvoir expliquer davantage. Voilà.
Thank you, Commissioner. Can I take some comments, initial comments from Minister Sila?
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Modérateur. Avant tout, je vais remercier très sincèrement le Conseil mondial de l'énergie pour cette invitation et remercier aussi le gouvernement turc pour l'accueil dont on a bénéficié depuis que nous sommes sur le sol d'Istanbul. Merci beaucoup. Vous avez bien écouté ce que Monsieur le commissaire chargé des questions de mines et d'énergie a dit. Moi, je vais vous donner des exemples concrets. Et aujourd'hui, l'intégration sous-régionale, dans ma région ouest-africaine, est une réalité. Je vais vous donner des exemples concrets qui vont vous édifier davantage. La Guinée, de par sa configuration, est le château d'eau de l'Afrique occidentale. Et mon pays dispose de 1165 cours d'eau avec 24 bassins fluviaux. Donc, vous avez le bassin du fleuve Sénégal. Donc, le nom du Sénégal vient de cette grande rivière qui prend sa naissance en Guinée. Vous avez le bassin du fleuve Gambie. Le fleuve Gambie aussi, la Gambie porte le nom de ce même fleuve qui naît en Guinée, dans les montagnes guinéennes, au Fouta particulièrement. Vous avez le bassin de l'autorité du Niger, donc le fleuve du Niger qui prend sa source en Guinée. Et deux pays africains portent son nom, il y a le Niger, il y a le Nigeria. Et il y a 9 pays qui s'abreuvent autour de cette source qui prend sa naissance dans mon pays. Vous avez la Mano Riva aussi, qui est partagée entre 4 pays, la Côte d'Ivoire, le Libéria, Sierra Leone et la Guinée. Donc, nos chefs d'État et de gouvernement se sont réunis très tôt et ils ont compris que ces fleuves-là, étant partagés entre les différents États, doivent pouvoir servir non seulement à l'intégration, mais aussi au développement de nos différents pays. C'est pourquoi le premier organisme de bassin qui a été créé, c'est l'Organisation pour la mise en valeur du fleuve Sénégal. Cette organisation a son compte déjà construit des barrages, le barrage de Manantali, qui desservent la République du Mali, le Sénégal et la Mauritanie. Et aujourd'hui, au compte du fleuve de cette organisation, vous avez Felou qui est déjà construit, et bientôt les travaux vont démarrer sur le haut bassin, ça veut dire en Guinée, la construction du barrage de Koukoutamba pour un productif de 294 MW. Et il va y avoir une ligne d'interconnexion qui va relier la Guinée à Manantali et l'intérieur de la Guinée aussi. Alors, ensuite, vous avez, dans le cadre de l'organisation pour la mise en valeur du fleuve Gambie, nous allons construire un barrage entre le Sénégal et la Guinée, qui, le barrage s'appelle Sambagalou. Il va faire 128 MW et l'usine va être du côté sénégalais et la retenue d'eau sera sur le territoire guinéen. Une boucle qu'on appelle la boucle énergétique de l'EMVG, qui fait 1675 km, va traverser la Guinée, la Guinée-Bissau, la Gambie et le Sénégal en arrivant bien sûr au niveau de la centrale même. C'est pourquoi elle fait la boucle. Et cette ligne de niveau de tension 225 kV va faire transiter 800 MW d'énergie. C'est pour vous dire jusqu'où c'est important. Et aujourd'hui, sur le fleuve Concouré, un barrage a été déjà construit qui fait 240 MW, qui s'appelle le barrage de Kaleta. 30% de cette énergie, dès que la ligne sera construite, sera déjà mise à disposition entre les quatre États. Et un autre est en construction qui fait 450 MW en ce moment. Et d'ici 2019-2020, ce barrage-là sera fini.
In the last month alone, we have seen significant investment announcements in the areas of gas to power, renewable energy, coal power, and even nuclear. All of this probably amounting to over $100 billion if one adds them up. The continent remains an attractive destination. However, yet for all the investment, some of the largest projects and biggest potential resides in regional energy integration. And unlocking this, multilateral, multinational projects remains a challenge. Some of them, conceptualized for many decades, remain in the planning stage, and several have been stalled for many years. Various reasons for slow progress in the continent. Africa needs to learn from lessons from across the world when it comes to regional integration projects, such as South America, Central America, and other economies, regional economies. The World Energy Council, together with the Deloitte, has published a paper on regional energy integration, where we reviewed the progress of some 20 priority projects using the 5-stage infrastructure lifecycle. We found that only 6 projects had made progress since 2015. Many remain stalled in the planning stages. Developing project feasibility, demonstrating bankability are the key stumbling blocks to the process. And some of the critical success factors for the regional projects are vision and leadership, as well as transparency, strong government support, and political stability. However, there has been some progress in areas such as the Southern African Power Pool, establishing a project acceleration unit, and signing several intergovernmental agreements to progress projects so that next year can be a better year for progress. With me today is the panel that will help unpack the subject of a vision for regional energy integration. I want to kick off by soliciting some initial viewpoints on what would it take to achieve successful regional integration for Africa. And let's kick off with Commissioner Bangura from ECOWAS.
(Clears throat)
Merci, Monsieur le Moderateur.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Before starting, I would like, on behalf of all of us, to express my thanks and my gratitude to the Turkish government for their hospitality and their invitation to enable us to share the vision concerning the problem of integration. This problem of integration, which will develop the development of energy infrastructure. Before continuing, I want to present the video, which is 15 members, 8 French speaking, 5 English speaking, and you will see the diversity of the 320 million inhabitants, 5.1 million square kilometers. That is a great market concerning electricity. A FIDEO has been established in May 1975 because the heads of state wanted to build the future of the population, because alone you can't do much, because we have demands in the field of energy, and we talk about the precarious energy in Africa, despite our potential, like the President Macky Sall said in the last General Assembly, Africa has great energy potentials compared to, and this is not unacceptable, because we have the resources, but we are not able to use our resources. Half of the population of Africa has not access to electricity. And in the rural areas, there are only 8% access to electricity, and 77% of the population lives in the countryside, and they do not have access to electricity. So after the creation of FIDEO, they have adopted regional energy policy, which is that the heads of state have expressed their political view to use their energy resources to eradicate energy problems. Of course, it takes time, but there is a political will. And since then, FIDEO was trying to bring together all the necessary instruments to implement this big regional projects. That is a sector which is based on capital. We need much money for that. And FIDEO has established some parameters, some policies, regulations, in order to give confidence to the investors in the field of energy. There is an energy chart. The energy protocol. So that defines the basis, the legal basis of investment in this field. The heads of state have asked the Commission to create institutions which will guarantee the investments. So I think that some of you know this institution and these projects. West African Power is an organization which is there to implement regional projects. The master plan of production and transport, production and interconnection between the states, African states, in the field of energy, to foresee and 2025, 10,000 megawatts and lines to be constructed, renewable energy. So this plan is there, and we're trying to follow it up. So there are some projects which
are,
have priority, and there are 51 projects, and I will talk about some of them. This is the first institution. The second institution is the establishment, because this sector needs private and public investments, and this is the regional authority. This is important because you have to give confidence, and there are potential of renewable energy, sun, wind. So we have to talk about and think about the future. How can we provide sustainable energy for our population? So there is a center of renewable energy and energy efficiency, which is responsible of the promotion of renewable energy, and which established the regional policy of renewable energy and energy efficiency, which are action plans which are implemented. So the heads of states have adopted it. And then we have gas. It's true that in certain meetings that for 2040 we have to leave that fossil fuels and protect them. So we are trying to make an energy transition for renewable energy. But of course, we have so many resources, and we have a gas pipeline going from Nigeria to Ghana, and the heads of states want to distribute it into 15 countries.
So
8% in the countryside. So this has been established, and we have a regulation authority and the society, private and public partnership. So we want that the big projects that we are implementing now allow us to sell energy, cheaper energy to the populations. So we have, of course, the distribution of energy resources are not fair. In some countries, you have, like Guinea, you have rivers, and 60% of their potential is hydraulic energy. So when we look at these institutions which have been established, and what did FIDEAO make? There are, of course, some constraints between the countries. We have a common tariff, so we try to harmonize the and we try to bring equity within the exchange, trans-border exchange between the countries. So on the 1st of January 2015, this has been adopted, and this common tariff will be completed in 2017, and we are going to, all the countries will adopt it. So renewable energy, if you adopt renewable energy, you can decentralize energy. You can go to a small village and have the solar energy. We come from a round table where there are some companies go to small villages to distribute energy. Well, sometimes they have problems, they encounter problems, but the regional organization is there to harmonize all the policies within the borders of the FEDEAO. This is one of the measures. And the second one is to allow the mobility within the space of FEDEAO. So when you enter from Guinea, you must have you must be able to go to these 15 states without problems. So the free circulation of people and goods is applied today practically. And we have adopted that also that which is if you go to a country, you need a working permit, but this biometric card will be used by all the citizens of the FIDEAO, because the aim of FIDEAO is to help people. Now, we want a federation of the people, citizens of FIDEAO. This is what we want to have. And you can go in any country of the FIDEAO and do business there. FIDEAO is a 40-year organization, but we made much progress to harmonize policies, to harmonize our directives, our legislations, in order to enable the energy sector to develop. Of course, this is not easy, because a state cannot work on its own. We need private cooperation. These are a few actions that the regional community of the FEDEAO is working. And with your kind permission, I will finish. Now, I want to show you this publication. You have the map of Africa in renewable energy. I think it's interesting. So when I look at this map, and I dream that one day when everything will be settled with you, private partners, institutional partners, that this renewable energy map with the implementation of projects, if we have 51 projects, that I hope that this map will be full, so that we can use, you can have many stations of renewable energy. This is a map which will improve, so you see how we are developing in Africa. As a commissar in the field of energy of FEDEAO, I must say that investments are welcome, and regional projects we're going to talk about, the interconnection lines, how do we do, how do we participate, what did we do. We have some power plants. Of my brother from South Africa is here with us, and this is a regional power plant which is providing services to neighboring countries, Nigeria, Niger, Burkina Faso, Ghana, Benin, and Togo, which will be a line of 3,000 kilometers, and we are trying to find funds to execute this project. I don't want to take too much of your time. But this is our vision of FEDEAO, which is looking towards the future, and we want a bright future. Bright because we're going to have light. So disponibility and access in 2040. We wanted to have 60% renewable energy until 2030. We'll reach 40%. Today, it is photovoltaic is 1% in Africa for the time being. Thank you, and I am ready to answer questions at the end of this session. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Can I take some comments, initial comments from Minister Sula?
Thank you very much, dear moderator. I want to give my sincere thanks to the World Energy Council for inviting me, and also the Turkish government for the wonderful hospitality here in Istanbul. You have heard what the Commissioner for Energy has said. I want to give you some concrete examples. In my region, in West Africa, we're dealing with a real situation, and I'll give you some concrete examples of this. Guinea, because of this, its configuration, is really the central hub for watering all of the region. We have 24 basins, more than 1,000 rivers. For the Senegal basin, this great river that is born in Guinea, we also have the Gambi River, which is also a river, which is also born in the mountains of Guinea. And we have the basin of the Niger River. Two countries bear the name of that river, Niger and Nigeria, and nine countries benefit from its water, and from another river that is born in my country. And then we have a fifth one that is shared by many countries. So our heads of states got together that this resource should be shared by all the states and serve to integration and development of our countries. So the first basin organism that organization to be created was established for the Senegal River, and it has built dams, and one at Manantali, which serves the Republic of Mali, Senegal, and Mauritania. And we also have another dam on Filou.
And
we will have the building of the barrage of Kudunkamba with 370 megawatt power, which will be serving the interior of Guinea. And in the context of the Gambia River, we'll be building a dam between Senegal and Guinea. It will produce 128 megawatts of power. And the dam will be in Guinea, and the plant itself would be in our country. And we have a river arm that has 1,800 kilometers, which crosses many of our countries. This will not be a river, but a cable, a main cable, and it will be transporting 800 gigabytes of energy. We have a dam of Kalata that has been built, and 30% of the energy here will be distributed to the four countries. Another dam of 450 megawatt, which should be terminated in 2020. One of these dams only will produce a huge amount of electricity. The 15 countries of West Africa have got together to develop instruments of development. We have an integrated cable line that is linking Guinea and Liberia, and another one will be entering the southwest of Guinea, and another one, you can see that on the map, and you can see on the map the lines that have been completed and those that are still being built. CLLG will have 1,300 kilometers of interconnection to be built. So Guinea has a potential of 6,000 megawatts. So the states have gotten together in order to develop this project so that they can provide all neighboring countries, not just not only the whole Western African region, not only countries that are along the rivers. So you have there the West African power pool, which will enable these countries to exchange their energy resources. It starts from Guinea and it all goes all the way to Nigeria. This involves 15 states. By 2020, all countries from our country, including our country, will be interconnected to a great extent, and they will be benefiting from electricity. So we are getting together not only to harness our energy, but also to integrate the Fouta-Galon Basin in order to save the ecosystem of this basin and protect the environment of all these basins, and the most important one being the Niger River, and we'll be reforesting these areas to stop erosion during the dry season and in order to protect the environment. So these works, these are great projects, and the BAD, the African Development Bank, is following these projects with interest, and it has created a vice president which will be in charge only of electrification for the whole region. And I'm very proud to be able to say here that the results obtained by my country, the President of the Republic of Guinea has been chosen for coordinator for the whole electrification of the region.
Great. Can we get a few comments from Southern Africa, Mr. Rukosa?
No, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm delighted to have heard the contribution from my colleagues from West and perhaps closer to Central Africa about what they intend to do, because that for me bespeaks political will. Your question was, what will it take for regional integration to be actualized? My response to that would be that, in fact, it should actually start with us as Africa. All manner of assistance can come from the World Energy Council and other related bodies, but it's got to start with us. First and foremost, we must ensure national and regional peace and stability. No foreign direct investor would be comfortable putting their capital in a region that is unstable. Second, we should crystallize our vision. And that vision should actually start with our continental vision. At one stage, a number of our presidents were talking about the African Renaissance, which was an umbrella vision. And within that broader vision, we should actually carve out regional visions and crystallize them so that would-be investors know that we know where we are going, because vision is that which beckons us as to where we should actually be going. But visions alone without policies that are predicated on a value system don't take us anywhere. So we've got to clear at the regional, at the national level and at the regional level what it is we believe in as nations and as nations that comprise the region. And that would actually bespeak how we mean to cooperate. And thirdly, as Africa, giving the leadership where that is concerned, I think we got to render ourselves attractive as a foreign direct investment destination. That calls for governance. Governance not only where politics is concerned, but even where economics is concerned. Governance even where corporations are concerned, because what energy you are going to produce will largely be consumed by industrialization. Now, what is the governance, what is the corporate governance prevalent in the nations that constitute the region that would like to attract foreign direct investment? I believe those three things where Africa is concerned would be critical. Making sure there's peace and stability nationally and regionally. In other words, amongst the states that comprise the region, crystallizing what it is we fancy is our regional vision, and making sure that governance is in place so people know what to expect when they come to invest where we are concerned. Secondly, I think the challenge of regional integration, the challenge of harnessing our resources, is just too big and daunting to be tackled only by our political leadership. Therefore, there is a need for public-private partnership. It must be genuine public-private partnership. The regulatory framework is provided by our political leadership, but most of the resources, most of the technology, will come from our public sector. And our political leadership must be a facilitator and an enabler in the partnership. I believe that will be critical to have in place. And thirdly, we must understand that, in fact, regional integration is not just something to be yearned for because it is nice to talk about. There are benefits that will flow from that. We must identify those benefits very, very clearly. Amongst others, the benefits would include optimal alignment of our natural resources. Our natural resources are not just sort of evenly distributed in the region. They are in certain areas, and other areas don't have that, but have high consumption ability. If you look at the relationship that Eskom had with Mozambique, at Cabrobasa, for instance, the generation of 1,800 megawatts could not be consumed by Mozambique. It could be consumed by Mozambique only via South Africa, and a great deal of that would be consumed in South Africa and in Swaziland. And the members of that regional integration initiative understood that by working together, there'll be synergies that will actually accrue from that. In the same region, if you look at the Southern African power pool, it was successful essentially because of the constituent elements, the countries that were actually involved there understood what benefits were going to be accruing from that. But very, very importantly, there was also a champion who actually championed the cause and served as a catalyst, the late John Marie. In spite of the fact that politically things were just beginning to gel with South Africa having just attained independence. He worked very, very hard to champion the cause of a Southern African power pool and the Southern African grid. So champion that, establish what the synergies are that are going to flow from regional cooperation. By working together as well, you actually become a commercial or economic bloc that, based on just the substance of working together as a region, you become a lot more attractive. And pooling resources, you can leverage those resources to borrow from the money market, because you actually have a lever. And that, I believe, would actually be very, very important as well. Technologies are also to be shared. And that also would enhance what needs to be done to achieve regional integration. Now, some of the regional integrations crossed a number of boundaries. My colleagues who spoke before spoke about Manantali. Manantali invited ESCOM as a catalytic agent. And because there was very, very strong political will, Manantali was realized. And he wound up with a successful regional integration initiative of a project that provides electricity to Mali, Mauritania, and Senegal. And all of that constitute the kinds of successful cases from which we can actually learn. But what are some of the cases that have failed but can provide us with lessons? Take the Inga project, for instance. We have been talking a lot about that, and some of us even wrote doctoral dissertations about it. But it doesn't really help to just talk. Africa must show bias for action. There was a time when it was optimal to utilize the cooperation in Southern Africa predicated on making Inga 3 work and using that as a stepping stone to Grand Inga, when ESCOM was actually highly creditworthy. A cooperation in those Southern African states with ESCOM as the catalytic agent would actually have led to success around the year 2000. But because we don't demonstrate bias for action, our leaders, political leaders in particular, quibbled amongst themselves, and we lost a golden opportunity. In West Africa, the gas pipeline, where lots of gas is actually flared in Nigeria, is being delayed essentially by bureaucratic red tape. So we appeal to our political leadership to minimize, if not eliminate, political bureaucratic red tape and give us the fillip that would enable us to actually work together, utilizing gas that is actually there and is just flared up into the air. I want to believe that using those case studies, the benefits that flow, the successes that have been notched up, and the failures that come about as a result of bureaucratic red tape actually provides a basis for us to discuss. Thank you very much, Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Khoza. Can we get some comments from Minister Ndenge?
Thank you very much. There is already a basis for cooperation in Southern Africa. My colleague has spoken about the existence of the Southern Africa Power Pool. It's a demonstration that cooperation can indeed take place amongst countries in the region. The Southern Africa Power Pool enables a country which is in deficit to draw upon surplus electricity from another country within the region. What has happened over the past decade or so is that there has been underinvestment in power generation, and there was a period, especially last year or so, every country was experiencing electricity deficit. And of course, Zimbabwe was one of them. This was caused largely by the drought which affected the low water levels at the Kariba Dam, which used to generate about 750 megawatts. And because of the rationing of the water for power generation, it went down to about 28 megawatts. And we have had to rely on imports from Eskom and from Hydro Kaburabasa. Where we need greater cooperation is in terms of power generation and transmission. I will first of all talk about cooperation, regional integration in terms of power generation, both at the bilateral and multilateral level. At the moment, there is a joint project being undertaken between Zimbabwe and Zambia, the Batoka Gorge. There are plans to generate 2,400 megawatts to be shared equally between the two countries, 1,200 megawatts for Zambia, 1,200 megawatts for Zimbabwe. Work is already advanced. The feasibility studies are being undertaken. They are being finalized. And we are now closer to that happening. There's been talk about generation at Batoka for the past 20 years. And I think for the first time, there is really some progress such that within the coming 2 years, we should see progress. And then another important factor is that power should be delivered to the public at the lowest possible rate. And Hydro offers such cheap rates. We estimate that at Batoka, we will produce the electricity to the final consumer probably at around 5 cents per kilowatt hour. Then the region as a whole, there is potential to produce at Inka Dam. I was talking to my brother Kosa this afternoon, you know, that at least the first phases can produce up to 23,000, and that is, you don't need to build a dam for that. Then the maximum which you can use from Inka is up to 44,000 megawatts. And through the Southern Africa power pool, when we are in deficit, we can also draw power from DRC, from the Democratic Republic of Congo. The other area where we need cooperation, and there's already some work underground, is in terms of transmission. We have a scheme called Zisabona, an interconnector which covers a number of countries within the region. Then we have another one, Mozisa, which covers the eastern side in terms of transmission. Then we have the central transmission corridor which runs through Zambia, Zimbabwe to South Africa. So these two areas need a lot of cooperation. It has been mentioned that with such mega projects, a number of countries don't have sufficient resources to undertake such a project. It has to be undertaken on a regional basis so that we maximize on resources, optimize, and move forward. I'm excited that there is willingness to cooperate among the Southern African countries. And the Southern Africa power pool, there are plans to extend it to the Eastern Southeastern Africa power pool so that the whole region will be interconnected. I'm sure that can even go as far as ECOWAS, so that Africa as a whole will be integrated. Perhaps I think I will stop at this juncture. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Let's turn our focus to Eastern Africa, or maybe not quite, but certainly Sudan. His Excellency Minister Salim, some initial comments from you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Moderator. Actually, in the context of Sudan, being cognizant of the fact that Sudan is a vast country, lies in the center of other eight countries around, sharing very long borders. This could pose a threat, but it could also stand as an opportunity. And the overarching philosophy adopted since almost two decades is actually interdependency is the only catalyst that could bring peace and stability around in the region. Within of this overarching philosophy, my country decided to take an action and to move a step forward from the theory of just regional interconnection at the theory, because now it's a well-established practice. We don't need to reinvent any wheel in this regard. So we moved into action, and one could easily trace the history of the region. And 20 years ago, we used to live in a situation where hostilities are across borders. Now this situation has been turned into a sort of cooperative interdependency situation. And now, at this moment in time, we are fully interconnected with Ethiopia, for example. Our two systems are working together. A 220 kV line is connecting the two countries. And it is in full operation since December 2012. We now receive almost 5% of our energy demand from Ethiopia. And now we are moving one step further. Next year, we will start the implementation of a 500 kV line at a higher level of voltage to interconnect the GERD, the Grand Renaissance Dam of Ethiopia, to the national grid of Sudan. This is quite a gigantic step forward in the interdependency and interconnection between the two countries. Second, we extended the line to Eritrea. Also, it used to be 20 years ago, not very stable border between the two countries, but now we supply at least the western part of Eritrea, which is, witness sort of very fertile land. Third, the state of South Sudan. Though there was a secession after 4 or 5 decades of being one country, they decided to go for their own on their own state, but we decided not to cut off the supply of power. We got one very main line supplying the northern part of South Sudan. It is in operation now for almost 4 or 5 years without any interruption. It is treated like a national line. And in this context, even we went even one step further. It is supplying. We are unable to get any sort of payments on this, but still, although we get our national people to pay for electricity supply, but not the case actually for the line supplying the northern cities of South Sudan. Four, coming also the interconnection with Egypt. On our part, we have now extended our lines to the border with Egypt. They are almost progressing on the same, coming close to the border, almost 66 kilometers left inside Egypt to interconnect with Sudan. But actually, what really conclude that the outcome, the dividends we are gaining from this interconnection is really peace and stability, and interdependency and sharing of interests and benefits that really has brought benefits to the nations, neighboring nations, that is much beyond just electricity and regional interconnection. One has to highlight that political will is the underlying secret word, because such interconnection, as has been highlighted, is not just a pure economical commercial decision. One could get maybe another better option to get better supply of power. But political determination, strategic approach, is a condition precedent for such regional interconnection, thanks to the leader around whom they made it possible. So people will go on doing more to further reinforce the peace and stability in the region.
Thank you very much for that. Mr. Ruggles, some opening comments from your side?
No, thank you, Shmuel, and thank you so much. Thank you to the organizers for hosting us today. I'd actually like to build off of what the Minister Sudan said. There's a time when we define energy security as each country having its own power plant, its own generation capacity. But in today's world, we in the United States have come to see that energy security comes from the interdependency, that interconnection, as well as diversity of supplies of energy sources. And so I think this panel on interconnections is very timely and an important topic to discuss. Specifically on when we talk about transmission, I think there's been a lot of focus on generation and obviously in the off-grid sector on renewables, all of which is very important. But there's such efficiencies that can be accomplished through interconnections as well. I'm based in Rwanda. I work throughout Africa. Part of my responsibilities is to represent the State Department within President Obama's Power Africa initiative. And one of the things Power Africa is doing is working with the Eastern African Power Pool, as well as various regional organizations, the EAC, NELSAP, EGL, and others, to achieve these interconnections. If you look at the situation today in East Africa, there's probably about 500 megawatts of shortage in generation capacity. Now, of course, these countries more or less exist in silos. There are very few interconnections in East Africa today. Small interconnection between Kenya and Uganda, Kenya and Tanzania. There are a number of projects that are underway, and indeed, as a minister from Zimbabwe commented, there are active projects to connect the Eastern African Power Pool and the Southern African Power Pool through a transmission superhighway, if you will. And that's important if you look at the situation that we're in with climate change, with drought that Southern Africa experienced. If you have an interconnected grid, parts of the continent that maybe weren't in drought, El Nino works both ways. Some parts of the continent had excess rain, other parts suffered drought. But if you're interconnected, you don't need to run the Kariba Dam turbines at full tilt during a period of drought. You can conserve that water. You can get the electricity from other parts of the continent. And so this is a vision that's being realized. Now, I asked some of my colleagues just to do some of the back of the envelope calculations. In East Africa, we're quickly getting to the point where we're actually going to be in the situation of excess capacity. So we calculate that by 2020, there'll be about 1,000 megawatt surplus. In 2021, that could be 2,000 megawatts surplus. But again, if the countries are still in silos, if they're islands unto themselves, the countries that are in surplus won't be able to sell that excess capacity to neighbors. So we're talking countries like Ethiopia, Uganda, even Rwanda, to countries that still may be in deficit, like Eastern DRC or South Sudan. And so there's a cost to that, and there's also a benefit that can be achieved as well. Again, back of the envelope, you calculate the cost of this imbalance could be about $1.3 billion in 2020. That's divided to $800 million in surplus capacity, as well as $500 million in insufficient, inefficient use of costly liquid fuels as well. If you count going forward between 2020 and 2030, the region could save easily $4 billion by being interconnected. So there is a number that we can put on the benefits, but part of the challenge is getting out of this mindset that a lot of countries are in, where the planning is done nationally without taking into consideration the regional potential and the regional benefits. And I have to be a little bit blunt when I talk to various governments in the region, and I'm not going to name names, but everyone is for regional integration and regional interconnection, but every country, almost without exception, views itself as the country that's going to sell the power to its neighbors. Very few countries are talking about buying the power from their neighbors. And so if the vision is only one of what can my country get out of it as a seller, then clearly progress is going to get caught up at a point where you're doing active trades. So looking forward, I think there's a couple takeaways that I have that I'd just like to share in terms of the region and how it can benefit. Again, need to get out of the silo mentality. There are organizations like the Eastern African Power Pool that are working to plan and prepare for the day for trades. But these organizations, and there are multiple regional organizations, that frankly, some of which have overlapping competencies, they're constructs of governments. And we need the political leadership of the governments of the region to signal to the private sector, a signal to their own utilities and countries, and signal to the development partners what exactly are the priorities, how's that vision going to be achieved. There are a number of challenges in transmission and development of transmission. Kenya and Uganda specifically have had issues with regarding land acquisition and right-of-way, which has slowed and delayed projects. You also have issues related to financing. I think we really need to think about public-private partnerships in transmission. How can we unlock the resources of the private sector in building this this infrastructure? Frankly, the private sector has been largely absent. We need to look at how can we bring them in. We need to think about transmission liberalization. Without open access to transmission network and the transparency surrounding pricing, wheeling power through a third or a fourth or fifth country becomes very complicated and for utilities. So transparency would assist. A lot of countries don't allow power generators to negotiate directly with industrial off-takers. We can reduce the middleman. That would save money, speed things up as well. And then as we get a little bit more sophisticated, when the current contracts that are under way to trade power in the region really relate just to baseload capacity. They don't take advantage of the full potential for some of these large hydraulic plants to act almost as batteries so that intermittent renewable sources can come online during the day or the wind when it's peak, and then having the hydro supplement that. But you're going to need a more sophisticated trading arrangement rather than just a take-or-pay contract as well. Finally, on the theme of transparency as well, need transparency regarding a forward view of surpluses and demand so that countries can negotiate with full information. So, in conclusion, East Africa, and I think Africa in general, just using East Africa to illustrate, is poised to benefit tremendously from these interconnections, but it does require political will and active leadership on the part of the countries in the region.
Thank you, Mr. Ruggles. So my takeaway from your opening comments is that you need a lot of political will. There would appear to be a lot of collaboration, but just based on your comments, Mr. Ruggles, it sounds like it's more co-opetition than collaboration in actual fact. This is all well and fine. However, the results of the regional integration projects, and the big ones in particular, seem to indicate that there isn't adequate movement, fast enough movement. What does Africa need to do to expedite these projects to get the benefits to the region? Because there is a real danger that some of these projects will still remain in limbo. And perhaps another part of the debate is that, are these the right projects to be pursuing? It's a question to the open panel, so any comments?
I'll just quickly respond to part of it and then allow my colleagues to jump in. But I actually want to reinforce something that Mr. Kosa said before with regard to the development of the Southern African power pool. It had a champion. And I really think that in the terms of these interconnections and these power pools, you need to have a champion to drive the projects forward. Absent that force to really will it forward, countries understandably will default to their own national planning, their own national interests. And so can't identify the champion, but if there are other champions, much the way SAP was developed, I think that would be sure. Tremendous help.
Good. Any other comments? Let's go with you, Minister.
Yeah. Donc, dans le cadre de ce que
in the field of what has been developed, when we will to eliminate risks of interrupted project, I can give you concrete examples. It all depends on the needs. All the states need energy to be able to develop. All the states are.
Il n'y aura pas d'émergence si toutefois il n'y a pas de d'énergie. Alors, dans ces conditions, chaque État met de côté
and each state,
ses propres valeurs
pour pouvoir
puts se mettre
its
ensemble.
Own values aside to get together.
So, de
there is Guinée has constructed a dam, hydroelectric dam, without the participation of other countries. But when you talk about the integration of Guinea, 30% of this energy was offered to neighboring countries. So, if there is a will, there is a way. Thank you.
Thank you. Minister Ndega.
Yeah, thank you. I think there is this realization that for us to achieve energy security, both at the national and at the regional level, there is need for some cooperation. For example, in Southern Africa, within the SADC framework, ministers of energy frequently meet. And of course, there are certain projects which we are all agreed that they cannot be undertaken by a single country because it doesn't have the money to do so. They can only be realized through the working together of two, three, four countries. That realization is there. But of course, there are certain projects which can be undertaken at a country level, at a national level, like development of renewable projects, solar energy projects, off-grid solutions. But all in all, we can have two categories. There are categories of projects which require different nations to put resources together. Then there are those projects which can be undertaken at national level. There's no competition there. I think there's complementarity. Thank you.
Go ahead, Mr. Kosa.
No, thanks. I
I believe, you know, when all is said and done, you have to fund the project. In order for you to fund the project, you must have a project that comes across as fundable. In other words, you need to do studies, you need to do feasibilities that actually bring the project for the region to bankability. And all too often, the money markets and the banks don't fund feasibilities or exploration. So you've got to find ways of accessing DFIs that actually are willing to fund the studies. You've got to work with the likes of this World Energy Council that does studies that give you the base and build on that base using DFIs to come up with a project that actually outlines things in such a manner that they can actually be implementable. And at that stage, you can then approach your money markets, you can approach your banks. Before then, banks and many of the other money markets who provide you with the finance would not look at you. So we have to find ways of doing studies, accessing funds that fund feasibility studies.
Thank you very much. Commissioner?
Je voudrais compléter. Vous savez,
I would like to complete this. Someone, investors, don't like uncertainty. What they want is stability and good governance. We have been in a panel where an investor found that his investment was completely bashed because of the fact that the tax system changed from one day to another. So we need a stable environment and good government. And the second point, when you talk about a project, the people will ask you if you have a feasibility study. So you need also the means to be able to have such a study. That's the second point. And the third point, they need guarantees. And you need to find the means to present these guarantees. It could be a sovereign guarantee from the state. And that's difficult. So we have that problem that we're faced with. And third point, when you produce something, energy is a product you have to sell, a commodity, and you need to be able to make profit from these sales. So you need to go back further up the chain so that we can be sure that the product reaches the users and the consumers at an equitable level while making sure that the producer will not lose money. So I think we need security, good governance, and stability. And regional cooperation is working on this. The Peace and Security Commission of the African Union are working on this to try to make sure that continent be in peace so that democracy may develop. That the involvement of governments can be put in practice and not interrupted. So these are the thoughts that come to my mind concerning the fact that we need to attract investors and create confidence for them.
Thank you very much. Minister Selim.
Thank you. Interconnection or any other projects of such a nature has a life cycle, let us say. It starts by creating conviction, sympathy, creating stakeholders around. Then you move into action. Once now at the stage where belief, sympathy has been put in place, action is somehow moving on. Now we are looking for one step further to move faster. But at the same time, these interconnection projects are of infrastructural nature, which is to some extent rigid in development, but at the same time very sensitive and has to do directly with sovereignty. The investor has not like any other type of investment. One could decide to say, no, I fed up with my investment. I want to shift my investment to another. He don't have this luxury. This liberty is not existing. Because once he decided to pick out his towers and cables, he will create blackouts and create a state of maybe war between the two countries interconnecting. So with all this in mind, the interconnecting states has to create their own, or they should craft their own vehicle, how to establish sustainable finance for such projects. And this is actually the example now brought around by Sudan, Ethiopia, and Egypt. Maybe some of us has heard about it, that they established a common fund for joint projects to be established between the three countries. This fund, if even though might not be sufficient enough to cover every single project, but it could act as a catalyst to bring around selective sort of funds with sovereign guarantees. That is maybe one way of accelerating the interconnection and interdependency projects. That it came to my mind.
Thank you very much. So I'd just like to summarize this discussion we've had here. With some concluding comments, as we are out of time. My takeaways is that you need to have political will to succeed from a regional integration perspective. There's got to be strong regional collaboration. You need to have strong institutions that can carry that political will across multiple political regimes, given that the lengthy nature of some of these projects. There has to be strong governance, both at the corporate level and transparency as well. We must not underestimate the role of the private sector in participating in regional energy programs. There's got to be a way to reduce the red tape to make this more attractive to various investors as well. What is clear is that regional integration is becoming more pertinent for mitigating against issues like climate change and redistribution of resources. And in doing this, you cannot do this in silos. You've got to do this from a regional planning perspective. The one very important point that I took away from this is that who is buying if everyone is selling? So you cannot work in that silo mentality. And of course, you do need a champion throughout this entire process. These projects have got to be bankable and fundable at the end of the day so that you can attract the necessary investors. So perhaps as a concluding comment from my side, vision without action is a dream. And action without vision just passes the time. Vision with action can change the world. That's a quote from Joel Barker. And I think that's a very pertinent quote in the context of regional energy integration here, because we have a number of projects that seem to have been caught up in a number of cycles that may lend itself to regional visions. But what we now need is discernible action so that we can make the change to the world, and we can see the benefits. With that, I'd like to conclude this panel and hand over to our MC.